Thanks very much, Sarah. Appreciate that. I appreciate everybody joining us today. Yeah, today what I'd like to do is update you on the announcement that we made and really start to focus on our plan for going forward. What this last opportunity presented for us really was an opportunity now where the company is going to sort of be a different company, and that we're not going to be looking at this as a well-by-well project anymore. It's really going to be a much more full cycle type oil and gas project that we now have based in Trinidad. Let me start out by talking about the cover picture that we see on here. This is our Chinook well. Picture was taken probably 3 weeks ago. And really what it was during the drilling phase. We're just in the midst of wrapping that up right now and moving that rig up to Cascadura, where we're drilling another well. It's about a mile up the road, but kind of gives you an idea of the size of the operation and what we're looking at there and what we deal with. Obviously going to be some forward-looking statements as we go here, so take those as you can, and please be aware that some of the things that we are talking about are on a forecast basis. The five main points that we want to, you know, that I think really separate Touchstone maybe from some of the other companies. We do have a proven experienced leadership team. Right from the board level all the way down through management. We've all been involved in the oil and gas business for decades, and certainly have the ability and have worked with companies that have sort of experienced the kind of explosive growth that we're going to see from Touchstone over the next four to five years. Our strategy is completely in Trinidad, although we're dual listed, as Sarah mentioned, both in Toronto and in London on AIM. We are, all of our assets are in Trinidad, and that's where we'll continue to be. And our real focus, although in the past it's been mainly on oil, will start to become a gas company as we move through 2021. Significant exploration opportunities. You know, this is a little bit of a carryover from the last couple of presentations. We've really moved a lot of our exploration acreage now into what I'll call development as a result of the recent announcements that we've had. But beyond those phase one exploration successes, we're now seeing a second round of opportunities. I'll talk about that a little bit. We're going to become a natural gas producer in Trinidad. I think it's really key. When you look at the infrastructure in Trinidad, it's really much more around natural gas than it is around oil. It's got a very large petrochemical business. It's got a large LNG facility. It's got existing pipelines. And quite frankly, right now, there's a shortage of natural gas for the petrochemical business. So it's a great opportunity for us to be able to bring these various assets on stream quickly. The fiscal advantages of natural gas in Trinidad, I'll talk about that a little bit later, but when I say the fiscal advantages, that's advantages over the existing oil production that's there. So the four pillars that we look at in the operation, we look at operating responsibly in Trinidad, and I think we'll be able to walk you through how Touchstone's gonna leave Trinidad a better place than where we found it. The exploration upside, so not only what we have now, but what we're looking at down the road over the next 10 years. Scalable economic growth, that would be more what I would define as our development side of things. And finally, how that flows through to value creation and what we see. On the ESG side and operating responsibly, 85% of our workforce, as mentioned, is Trinidadian. 26 of those are women. And that's about double what the average is in Trinidad, and we continue to focus on that and diversity as we move forward. Got a great environmental and a safety record. You know, put in here that we've got 768 days of accident-free time. Unfortunately, 2 weeks ago on the rig, somebody did slip and scrape their shin, so that starts at zero again and gets reset, unfortunately, but also happy to report not a major incident. You know, the other couple of other things that we're looking at doing is eliminating venting gas, flaring gas, and effluents, and that's certainly worked well. We also work really well with a number of the community schools in the area and working forward to improve how things are operating out there. COVID, we get a lot of questions on COVID. We've implemented some pretty stringent things in the workplace. A number of those affect the operational side of things. However, I can say that everything's continued to work through COVID. It's working differently, but we continue to work through COVID as we go. And we've also done some great things in the community. You can see in this picture here that we distributed over 400 hampers to various families in the local communities that we operate. And those were supplied by a local supplier. So it kind of fit two modes for us, one helping the supplier, but also helping the communities. And we'll continue to do that as we move forward. That's the start of this process, certainly not the end. Onto our map in Trinidad, we really have two different operations in Trinidad. We've got that developed acreage, which is basically our historical oil properties that we've been working on for about 10 years. Low rate, you know, 50 to 150 barrel a day wells, cost about $1 million to drill, highly economic, even at today's prices, they are highly economic. But our real focus has been on our exploration acreage on the east side of the island. And I think over the last couple of years, we've talked about it, certainly on these presentations, where we've now gone from the phase of a concept to moving in the drilling rig to where we now have three successful wells that we've drilled. And, you know, if you take a look at the proven plus probable reserves there, we came into the year with about 18 million barrels, and it looks like we'll come out of the year at north of 67 million barrels of oil equivalent. So kind of gives you an idea of that step change that we've seen, certainly in Trinidad for us. This is a more detailed map of that particular area. And what you can see here is the outline in yellow is our block that we have. And there's three things I'd like to point out on this map is, first of all, the gas properties, which are those pinky red properties that you see, the central block one that's down in the left-hand corner of this particular illustration. That's a field that's been on production for 20 years. It's probably going to do over 500 BCF of gas and about 25 million barrels of liquids. So that's the analogous field that was kind of the key field that we felt there had to be more of these in Trinidad. And so what we did is we've been focused on expanding that, and I'll talk about that. There are two things to point out on this map. Are the red line going through the middle is the main gas pipeline that goes up to the petrochemical facilities I talked about. The green or the red triangles on there are the tie-in points. And then the green line going through the middle of the map as well is an oil liquids line that we can tie in for any of our liquids. So the infrastructure is in a great position for what we see. To orientate you as well, you see a well called Coho just north of that central block. That was the first well we drilled that was a gas discovery. We then moved over to Cascadura where we had another gas discovery and it's tested. We then moved south to Chinook, which was the announcement Sarah talked about. I'll expand on that a little bit more. And we're now currently moving the rig back up to Cascadura. And then in late Q1, Q2 of next year, we'll go and drill Royston. It's interesting, when we started this presentation, the team, James, Scott, and myself, we defined these plays in two ways. We talked about them as world-class natural gas opportunities, and then we also discussed them as being offshore-type opportunities onshore. That's kind of the size of what they were when we looked at them. And I'll walk through now, and I think that some of those comments have now been justified as we see. So the five opportunities and things that we'll talk about here at the Oratoa block, and this is really the first phase of exploration. You'll see the second phase as I get to the very end here, but the first one was the Coho well, tested a little over 11 million cubic feet a day. Our plan in when we went in was around 8 million cubic feet a day, so that certainly exceeded expectations. The Cascadura well, the second one we drilled, it shows here that it tested 5,000 BOEs a day. That was actually out of one zone. It actually tested that virtually that same amount out of two zones. Again, far exceeding expectations. To give you an idea, we were looking for about 400 BOEs a day equivalent. So, you know, probably 10 or 20 times what we expected. The Chinook well, which we talked about last week, although it hasn't been tested, had about 609 feet of pay in it. I'll expand on that in a minute. We're now moving up that road and literally across that bridge. Loads are going across that this week, and we'll be drilling that very shortly. And then the final one that we'll be looking at drilling in Q1, Q2 next year is the Royston well. And you can see the guys are on that tractor there. That's the old road in. We'll have to do some work on that before we can move the rig in. Just give you a little more detail, and I'll go through these fairly quickly, and you can take a look at them. I'm not going to kind of read them word for word, but the Coho was the first well that we drilled. And really the reason we wanted to drill it was an offsetting an old well drilled in 2000 that we thought had bypass pay in it. Although it was the smallest well that we identified, it also had tested hydrocarbon, so we felt it was the less risky and we could learn some things around the model, so we did that. Interesting, when that comes on stream here, probably be January or early February, that's a couple months later, I think, that people were hoping. But with COVID and various other things, we just have not got approval from the government yet to start putting pipe in the ground. As soon as we get that, we'll give everybody the exact date on that. But basically, that'll double production from where we are today to add between 1,300 and 1,600 BOEs of production for us. Cascadura, we then moved over there, and these were the two tests I talked about, the upper test and the lower test. And basically combined, this well is capable of over 10,000 BOEs a day. The challenge for us will be that the pipe we have in the hole right now just can't manage 10,000 BOEs a day. So we're going to have to drill additional wells in order to fully develop that field. But initially what we'll do is we'll focus on production out of that upper test. So when it comes on stream, it should add roughly 5,500 BOEs a day, mainly natural gas, although there is a significant amount of liquids in this particular well. And again, when I, you know, if you were to go back and look at our presentation over a year ago, we were looking for a 400 barrel a day oil well. So, I think sometimes really good things happen when you drill wells, but it's also key that we're in a hydrocarbon rich environment. This is great rock, and you put those together, we can see the opportunities on the trend. We then went south to Chinook, and that was the well that just finished up a couple of weeks ago, and we ended up with virtually twice as much pay in the main zone that we had anticipated. And again, this was offsetting an old well that was drilled back in the 1950s. But this well was really key in that it was the first one that we really tested the model on. It had never had any hydrocarbons tested out of it in the previous well in the 1950s. So this was really the first time we looked at the model. And the key thing is we're right in the middle of this big sand fairway that runs through the middle of our block. The 3D that the technical team used, the tops came in exactly the way we had expected them to do. So, I think from a technical point of view, this well probably was more significant than Cascadura in that it really de-risked the block for us as we go forward. The next well we're going to drill is the Cascadura deep well. So it's going to follow up the original discovery. But to be quite honest with you, it's an exploration well. We're targeting two thrust sheets that are much deeper than the existing well that we discovered. So there's still a high degree of risk in this particular well, but it opens up again the fairway. And what we know about from the Chinook results, I think we feel more comfortable in what we look at there. I've got a map that, or a 3D map that we've dropped in here. And I think it's a little bit helpful visually for people. So what this is a 3D slice, like a three-dimensional slice of the data that we have in there. And what you can see is there's two anticlines. And for those that maybe aren't as technical, the anticline is like a big hill underground. The synclines are the valleys and the anticlines are the big highs. And what we're trying to do with the data is to hit those highs right on the crest of the structures as we can. And what you can see at Cascadura there is the first well that we drilled at Cascadura tapped into that top sheet of sand right on the top of the structure. And it turned out to be a fantastic well. Unfortunately, just the way the rig was set up, we weren't able to drill any deeper. So what we're doing now is we're now going back to that same surface location. We're going to move a little bit further away on the bottom hole. And what we want to do is go down and drill that second sheet and then get down to that red zone that you see in the bottom, which is a very, very large structure that we see sitting under Cascadura. Then you move over to the Chinook anticline. What you can see there on Chinook is that red line that we drilled that went all the way down. It almost goes down to the bottom of that illustration. It's kind of clouded out in the bottom, but the well actually TD'd right in the very bottom there of that formation. And what we actually saw was for the first time in that area, we saw hydrocarbon out of that very, very lower sheet. And two significance to that is, one, there hadn't been a well drilled that deep. The team was able to get it to over 10,000 feet. So it's the first time that we've seen hydrocarbon that deep. And the other significant part of that is that we think that potentially that deep prospect at Cascadura and the deep zone that we just tapped into at Chinook could be connected. So it would give them much more aerial extent than what we see in these upper sheets, and really sets up a very big opportunity for us and, quite frankly, for the whole country of Trinidad if some of these lower sheets also are hydrocarbon bearing. So stand by on the Cascadura deep. I think it's going to be really exciting when we look at it. And the team, specifically James, kind of made a call when we were drilling Chinook that we were back into sand at the bottom of the well. We were going to TD it, and they made the decision to go ahead and drill deeper because we started to see some hydrocarbons. So it looks like it's going to be a really interesting opportunity for us. And then the final well that we'll drill in the first phase of the exploration program will be Royston. This has always been, since day one, the largest prospect that we see on the block offsetting an existing old well. So an old well that was drilled in 1965 by Shell, we think we can move in right next to it, move it up structure. And, you know, we think this well's been significantly de-risked since the Chinook well. And I guess maybe de-risked is a little aggressive, but I think we feel more comfortable certainly looking at this well as we go. But again, very large potential reserves. And then beyond that, and this is really a question that we're starting to get, is that, you know, we've identified 24 different prospects. We've now drilled three of them. We'll drill the fourth one at Cascadura Deep and the fifth one at Royston. And then following that, what we've identified is all these other anticlines with all these other sand bodies right in the heart of the fairway that's really setting up a very long exploration runway for us as we go forward. You know, and it's different horizons too. It's almost like a 3D chess match where you've got different sands, different levels draping over these big highs. And the only way to find out whether they're hydrocarbon filled or not is to drill them. So we've got lots of things to do out here for a number of years. So look back quick at 2020. What were our corporate goals? Is to get a natural gas contract signed for the Orotowa block. We did sign a heads of agreement. We're in the final stages of signing off that agreement, and hopefully we'll be able to release something in the next month. It's going to be a great agreement for us in that the national gas company is going to build all the pipelines into all of these wells, and we won't need to build gas plants or pipelines. All we got to do is drill wells, get them on production, and then they'll pay us in US dollars virtually at the wellhead. So unfortunately, covered by an NDE, I can't talk about the actual gas price because it's pretty sensitive in Trinidad with the petrochemical business as being their main source of fuel. But what we will be able to tell you is it's going to be very competitive. And if anybody knows where Trinidad gas prices are, we're obviously in that range. We want to drill Chinook 1 and Cascadura Deep. Those are both going to happen. Coho, we wanted to bring it on production, as I mentioned, just from regulatory approvals. That's going to be a little later than we hope for. That's going to end up being a 2021 success. And then we want to formulate and design a way to bring Cascadura on stream. That's changed too. With the Chinook success now, we're going to have to expand that whole project. And as the team says, we're going to need a much bigger pipe to get gas out of Cascadura and Chinook now than what we originally anticipated. So what do we got now at the Orotowa block? We got a 10-year drilling program, the 21 targets I talked about. We've maintained a very good relationship with both the Crown Corporation Heritage and the National Gas Company. So we're in Trinidad for the long pull. They're excited to have us there. And they're working very closely with us. And I think the most exciting part is that this particular community that we work in, we're going to focus on a long-term strategy to make it a much better place than when we found it a couple of years ago. So it's exciting to have that opportunity as well. The scalable economic growth, these are really our oil wells on the west side of the island. They are highly economic, even at today's prices. We've got 208 drilling locations. It would take a different rig than what we're using at Orotowa. But at this point, we'll just continue to keep pushing forward on that. These are our first half numbers. I don't really need to touch on them. I think the key one there is we had cash of about $6.8 million. We also received another $2.8 million from the government in a VAT refund post the end of the quarter. So obviously, we were fully funded for drilling the program that we've got. When I say the program, we've got for Chinook and then moving up to Cascadura. Scott also put in place a $20 million term facility right in the middle of COVID. I'm still not quite sure how pulled that one off, but we've only drawn $15 million of that. So we also have $5 million of additional liquidity there for drilling the next well. And then on top of that, obviously the bank is excited about extending that facility further if we need to, because we obviously have much more assets than we have right now. But our key is to keep the balance sheet clean. So that people have a very simple way of evaluating the company. Quickly on the natural gas fiscal advantages, Trinidad's really set up to be a natural gas producer's country. The royalties on natural gas are 12.5%, as opposed to, you'll hear a lot of noise in the market sometimes about oil, and really there's three royalties on oil. There's a base royalty of 12.5%. Then you pay another royalty to Heritage, which can be up to 30%, depending on what kind of license you have. And then when oil gets over $50, you pay another 18%. They've just moved that hurdle rate up to $75. But having said that, when you compare the advantage of the oil versus the gas, you can see that gas is much more valuable in Trinidad. So we're pretty excited to be headed down that road for 2021. So the investment summary for us is obviously keep, you know, environmentally responsible, take care of our people, take care of the community we're involved in. The exploration opportunities, we're coming to the end of phase one, but that isn't the end of the exploration. I think what that really is going to be a higher confidence level to move to the second part of the exploration in the block. Multi-year drilling program, got a good balance sheet to get us forward, and the key is just to get those production, those wells on production as quickly as we can so that we start to generate, you know, I've referred to it before as a wall of cash, but that's really what it's going to look like once we get those once we get Chinook and Cascadeur on stream. And we've got the people in place to make that all happen. So on that note, I'll maybe open it up for questions.
Well, you didn't disappoint us. You said wall of cash. I wondered when you were going to incorporate that into your presentation, because some of the investors know you as Paul, wall of cash, Baay. So there you go. You got it in right at the end. But listen, I'm standing by on the Cascadeur Deep. You told me to stand by. I'm standing by. But you didn't actually give us a timeline. You have for Coho, January, February, when that comes on stream, you're going to double production. The Royston gas prospects, you're talking about quarter one or quarter two of next year, but you're telling us to stand by on the Cascadeur Deep. How long are we standing by for?
So Sarah, the rig's moving this week and it's probably about a 40-day drill. You know, and I got to touch wood on that because, you know, things happen when we're doing these things, but hopefully we'll have a Christmas present for everybody, you know, probably be the middle of December, when we look at doing that. You know, one of the other questions that's come up is why we aren't able to test, Chinook right away. I know, and I apologize. I should have mentioned that in the presentation. Part of that is because it's the same road. You come into Cascadeur and then you have to go to Chinook. And having two operations going at the same time, drilling Cascadeur Deep and testing that well, it's not a very safe atmosphere with only one way out of there. So I think people are going to have to wait for the Chinook test until after we're done Cascadeur Deep. And I forgot to mention that.
I'm just wondering how forgiving a person you are. You talk about Christmas presents. You're hoping to give us a Christmas present in terms of some news. But the person who scraped their shin, are they going to get a Christmas present for you? Because three successful wells, one scrape of the shin. How cruel is that?
Yeah, to be honest with you, it's quite disappointing. We had a great track record going there for sure on that. But, you know, I think all we can hope for is to minimize a lot of these things and learn from especially the safety accidents that we do. But it's always the top of the list. And we get excited about the three successful wells, but it doesn't happen without the people doing it. So we got to focus on them first of all, for sure.
So in terms of those three successful wells, Adrian Bradshaw says, based on the exceptional results today and the 3 out of 3 discovery rate success, do you propose to raise equity or will you extend the loan facility should you require further funding now that Coho is delayed?
Yeah, I think that's probably the number one question, and I appreciate it. I won't dance around it too much in the sense of we have not made a decision on that. And really the key would be is if we decide to expand the program, you know, and really go after this, it's pretty simple math to see that there's not enough cash coming in, even if Coho comes on, to fund a multi-rig program out in Oratoa. So we'd have to look at one of two things. We'd either have to expand the debt facility, or we'd have to look at some equity. We don't need to make that decision right now. And I think that's the key thing. Is give us a little time to figure it out and we'll go forward. But, you know, I don't want to mislead anybody. We've raised equity in the past and I think it's the right thing to do for exploration drilling. You know, stretching the balance sheet to drill exploration wells. My history in the patch has been that usually results in a dry hole. It's just kind of the way Mother Nature deals with it. So I think that's really the balance in what we want to look at. So, you know, I'm not going to say no because we've obviously done it in the past, but I think there's a right time to raise equity and there's a right use for debt and we'll use them accordingly.
Because you did remind us that you've got a current cash balance of circa $11 million. You had that $2.8 million VAT repayment And the $9 million placing. So it looks as though you've got sufficient funding, but as you said, you're not going to fudge us, and you're just working on your options that are available at the moment.
Yeah, I think that's a great summary. It's a great summary.
Thank you. Okay, Ben Morn says, Paul, it looks like, I don't think he says it as dramatically as that, but let me just be a bit dramatic. It looks like Cascadura footprint extends into the neighboring block. How might this potentially impact revenue for Touchstone?
Yeah, and I think you got to be a little careful when you look at some of those maps. We draw them fairly generally on these presentations. Obviously, we don't want to let our competitors see everything. But most of these fields are fault-bounded, and we've got really good control. So at this point, we actually don't see them spilling into other blocks. That doesn't mean that they couldn't, as you develop them out, you could see those expand beyond those particular blocks. But at this point, we're not worried that would have to do a pooling or something like that to get it on production. That's just not in the ballpark. These are really thick sands in a really concentrated area. So, we take a little bit of license sometimes when we draw the red area as more of an, I'll call it more of an assessment area than an actual pool outline. So I think that's probably a better way to look at some of those maps.
Well, Paul McGrory's been looking at the maps as well. He's saying that given Coho sales are likely to come first after Cascadura Deep, will the next well to be drilled be Coho 2? And if so, can you now drill the 9,200 feet deep target? And he says the question is based on the Royston well that needs a 6 month road build. So I'll put that up for you because there's multiple elements to that question. It's up there for you now.
Yeah, I think it's a really simple answer. No, we're not going to drill Coho 2. We're going to let Coho 1 probably produce for a couple of years before we go back in there. It's got a good straw into that pool, so we don't really need to do that. And then the second part of that is, I think what we've got is we've probably got three or four development wells to drill at Cascadura. Even if Cascadura Deep doesn't work, we've got development wells in the Cascadura pool. And hopefully, touch wood, Chinook testing properly, we'd have multiple wells to drill in Chinook as well. So that's more where the development's going to take place. And then on the exploration side, we probably have a separate rig because we need a little bigger rig to drill Royston. There's one on the island, and we've committed to it for the second quarter of next year to go down to 12,000 feet. So, in a perfect scenario, and I think this is where his question's going, is you'd have a deep rig drilling over at Royston, a number of targets we've got over there. You'd have development drilling going on at Cascadura and Chinook. And I know Scott will come unglued here, but I'll take that chance. We'd have a third rig drilling some of our development oil properties on the west side of the island. If prices hold in this $40 to $50 range, those are pretty economic as well. So you're going to see those three programs going in 2021.
William Wood asks, will you bring in a bigger test setup for Chinook than was used on Cascadura?
Yeah, and I know that question goes to the fact that when we tested Cascadura, the equipment was the limiting factor of the test. And we mentioned that in both of our press releases and the presentations. Probably not. And the reason is, there's no real advantage to getting to the ultimate test size. We can do that mechanically, and the engineers can do that with their slide rulers and figure out where the actual test is. What's really more important is the pressure, especially the downhole pressures that we get on these tests. So the answer to that question is highly unlikely. We'd like to go with what we know works on the island. It's on the island right now. And quite frankly, with COVID, the island's locked down. So we have to work with the services that we have. And I don't see that changing, certainly over the next 4 or 5 months while we want to get that test done. But I don't think we end up with worse data because of the equipment we've got. It may just not be as dramatic a number, a restricted number than what everybody would like to see. But as far as the data goes, we're going to get great data with what we have.
And in terms of what you know, Paul Moore asks, would you consider Chinook a world-class discovery?
Yeah, it is. It was bigger than what we thought. So I don't think that changes. If you look at that little seismic diagram that I put up, you know, I can actually maybe flip back to that if I go quickly, but really they're very different structures, and that's what an exploration program is, right? You want to try different concepts, different types of wells that you want to drill. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble getting back here, but you know, and what you can basically see when you look at that map on 14 is Cascadeur is very like a very sort of high structure, very pointy, whereas Chinook is much more of a gradual, broader structure. So they are very different. But I would put both of them in the world class category for sure, in my definition. Anyway, I'm not sure there's an official one in the dictionary there, but it would be in mine.
No, I think you answered this in the presentation, but there's a couple of questions coming up about the delay in Coho. It's been delayed until 2021. And the notes that I wrote down were it was COVID-19 related.
Yeah, it partly that, and partly the fact nobody's built a gas line on the island for 20 years, right? So, you know, right in the middle of this pandemic, we're trying to do something that hasn't been done for 20 years. We've got the pipe, the pipe's coated, the tanks are good. We've got all the engineering done, separators all good. This is just getting the government signed off and making sure that we've got all the I's dotted and T's crossed. Give you one example is normally what you would do a couple of town hall meetings where you could address the community, some of their concerns, some of their ideas. Unfortunately, we can't do town hall meetings in COVID. So what it's meant is we've had as many as 57 one-on-one meetings that the team's been doing in Trinidad. And that just takes longer. Then we compile that data, put it together, put it back to the government to do the evaluation on it. And all I can say to everybody is as soon as we get the approval, we know how long it's going to be to put the pipe in the ground and when we get it on stream. So as soon as we get the approval, we'll make an announcement and tell everybody exactly when that's going to be.
Okay. Well, everybody includes the current investor pool who are very protective and very possessive. And I talk about there's lots of possessive terms being used, such as our. And Matthew Osborne asks, how many turbidites exist outside our block? Thus, how fast do we need to move? We meet Trinidad gas demand before somebody else does, can we?
Yeah, I love that hour part. I'm delighted to have anybody that wants to be part of the team. It's great. But, you know, the main turbidite, really, that fairway that we have in Oratois, the reason we bid on it is it's basically, that's the main syncline or the main valley. And so what you have is you have those turbidites that are coming down and dumping down into that valley. And that's why we bid on the block. So the question is, you know, are there some that lie off of this block? Yes, but we are in the main fairway, and you know, James and the team have really identified it. Like, there's not many places in the world where you get 1500 feet to 2000 feet of turbidite section. You know, it's not all pay, but that just puts us right in the middle of the fairway. And as you move more down towards the other part of the island, there are some additional opportunities in the Herrera, but they're just not as the overall gross pay thickness just isn't as big as it is that we see there. And then if you look at that one map, there's also a big fault that's on the east side of the island, and that becomes the eastern boundary of this play. Like, it doesn't continue on forever. So it is in an area, and we think we've got the heart of it. There's probably a couple of pieces that spill over onto the neighboring acreage, but we'll deal with those later.
You've referenced James twice in the past 10 minutes. For those who are not part of the gang yet, if you can tell us a little bit more about James and his importance to the project.
Yeah, so James is our chief operating officer, and he's obviously been key in putting this together. He's got a geological background, which I think has been key for an exploration company. But most importantly, the team that he's put together, which is, you know, partly in Canada, but a big chunk of them in Trinidad, has really been the key of taking some of the local knowledge that we have in Trinidad. I mean, they've been producing oil there longer than we have in Canada. And, you know, harnessing some of that knowledge from those old wells from the 1950s and 60s, and then putting that together with today's technology. And it's we can start to see the results of that. You know, there's going to be some bumps in the road here. Like, I hope nobody thinks we can continue on 100% success rate, because these are exploratory wells. But hopefully we learn something from every one of them as we go, and, you know, it can lead on to other things as we go. So that's my cautionary statement for today.
Yeah, there is a question that's been asked about lessons learned from Cascadura in particular, but I do not have time to ask that question. I'm going to end on a nice sort of collective wrap-it-all question from Adrian Bradshaw, who says, given the success now and with Shell sitting in the neighbouring block, do you see a risk right now of a major swooping in and taking over Touchstone early?
I don't, and I'll tell you there's sort of two reasons for that. One is I think we're still really early on in this project, and you know, majors like to deal with something that's kind of at a later date, and I know this is going to sound terrible, but this is huge for us, and it's, you know, huge as a name company, but it's not going to move the needle for a Shell or a BP or one of those, you know, those companies. So, you know, I think there's been lots of talk about that, and lots of rumors swirling around, but certainly, you know, we're really early on, and you know, it's big, but we'll just have to wait and see. And you know, I guess that's something we'll deal with when we go to deal with it. And if it were to happen, I think the nice part is there's a whole bunch of players in Trinidad, right? You know, it's not like it's one company that owns the country. So you got Shell, you know, BP, BHP, Billiton, EOG. You've also got the other end users of the gas, which are, you know, Methanex and all of those buyers that, you know, I think if you really did get into a situation, I think you'd have a really great auction. And I'm, you know, that's life. But I just don't think that somebody, let me rephrase this. Nobody's going to be able to steal this from us. There's too many players in the market. So if that ends up happening, I'm sure that we'd get full value for the team.
Final question from me. Market cap of £192 million. The previous two presenters say their stock is undervalued. Is yours?
Yeah, I think it's really interesting. When you look at the evaluation that was done by the third-party engineers, just for Cascadura alone, the value was about $380 million on a best case, so not high case, but not low case, so somewhere in the middle there. So, you know, when you take a look at that, you look at the results from Chinook, you look what we've got on the value, I think it's fair to say that it's certainly not fully reflected in there. But I also, you know, I'm not naive enough to think that there is going to be a time lag here between when you've got the asset in the ground and when you got it on production. And so there's sort of that, I think there's going to be that lag in what we want to do. And you know, I don't know the exact number. I think we're up like 350% this year as far as share value goes. So, you know, that's also a, you know, pretty aggressive move. So there's going to be that lag of people that are going to be selling at the same time. And I'm always happy when people sell that have made money. That makes me happy too. So it works well.
Thank you very much. There's a ton of questions that I haven't been able to ask you. So again, I'll book you in for a follow-up interview and we'll make sure all those questions are answered. Paul Baay, thank you very much indeed. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much.
Always really appreciate it.